I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. Good morning, I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane. Glad to have you along, and it's going to be a wonderful program today. We continue our series of examining changes, challenges, opportunities for communities of color in Minnesota. Today's focus is on the shifting demographics. Who are we as Minnesota? How have we changed in the past generation? And what will the demographic shifts in the future mean? My guests today include Hollis Winston, who is chair of the African American Caucus of the Minnesota DFL organization. Keith Downey is the chair of the Republican Party of Minnesota. Keith, thank you for being here. Anika Robbins is a community organizer, a business leader, a thought leader, and cultural champion in Minnesota. She's here representing Black Votes Matter, an important initiative. And Susan Brower is Minnesota State Demographer. Thank you all for being here. Susan, let's begin with you. Who are we? Describe us as a community, as a state. And, you know, obviously I'm interested in what we as African, Latino, Asian, Native American, other emerging ethnic populations mean to the present picture. Mm-hmm.
So we are a state that is becoming more diverse every year, and particularly in the last generation, so particularly since about 1990. Right now in Minnesota, we have 1 million people of color. That we just reached that 1 million mark, and it's about 19% of all residents. You know, if you look a little deeper into specific communities, the largest communities of color here in the state are U.S.-born African Americans, Hmong, Somali residents, and Mexican. So we've done some work to kind of look specifically at those groups.
What are the numbers, relative numbers?
The largest, of course, is still white, white non-Hispanic, about 81%. And then African American, U.S.-born African Americans, and then Mexican, Hmong, and Somali, in that order.
Okay. And then is there some strategy by which African Americans, native born, and Somalis are included as Africans or Black or not?
Yeah, there's a lot of statistics that look at the numbers that way. We've done some work to kind of pull that apart because there's such different experiences that those communities have had. There's shared experiences too, but many times they're grouped together as African American or Black.
Sure. How's the future look?
Well, we'll continue to get more diverse going forward, in part because of immigration, what we expect to see in terms of immigration, although that's more up in the air in recent months. But we'll become more diverse just because of who the parents are in Minnesota, that we have a much more diverse, racially, culturally diverse group of folks in their 20s, and these are the people who are likely to become parents, and then our nurseries become more diverse.
There are predictions that by date certain, minorities will be the majority. What are the numbers?
Well, for the U.S., that comes up pretty quickly because the U.S. as a whole is more diverse than the state of Minnesota. So right now, the U.S. is about 36% populations of color. And the projection is that that will flip to over 50% by about 2040. Now we're much lower, we're about 19%. So it's further out into the future for the state of Minnesota.
But if you look at Twin Cities, which is where most people of color are, how does that equation spell out?
Yeah, so if you look at the Twin Cities, you see more racial diversity, particularly the Twin Cities metro, it's about a quarter of the population, so a bit higher. And also if you look at the younger age groups, you see much more diversity. The youngest age group, our youngest residents under age 5 here, about 30% of that group are children of color.
And so in 5 years or 10 years, that group emerges as what?
In 5 to 10 years?
Yeah, what does that shift mean in terms of the racial composition of the Twin Cities or the market area in another 10, 12 years?
So if you think about kind of the ages at which we participate in different activities, you start to get a sense for where diversity is happening, which institutions, which areas. Our schools are already very diverse, much more so than our workplaces, but that's changing as the baby boomers, who are largely white non-Hispanic, are retiring and taking their place at the younger end is a much more diverse, 19, 20, 21-year-olds. So it really depends on the institution that you're looking at. It depends on the geographic area that you're looking at. But the big picture is just more racial diversity for Minnesota all around.
Let me make this personal for you, Susan Brower. Are you from Minnesota? Are you native here?
I am. I'm from Minneapolis.
Okay, so talk about your experience as a young person, as a child growing up, how this community looked to you, how it looks now, and what do you expect it'll be for your children or your people that follow you?
Absolutely. I would say, growing up in Minneapolis public schools, I was in Southwest Minneapolis, so some of the first experience with diverse cultures was when there were Southeast Asians that began arriving in the 70s in Minneapolis as refugees. So this was some of my first hand experience, but it was still relatively rare in Southwest Minneapolis in the 70s to have close ties with populations of color as a white girl. For my kids, the picture, we're also in Minneapolis now, the picture is very different. So when I go to make a play date with my children's parents, I speak through the children because I don't speak Spanish well enough or Somali well enough to be able to make some of those connections. So it's a different relationship that my kids have than the experience that I had as a young person.
So is it desirable from your point of view? Do you feel enriched by the ability to connect with more people than just white people? What's your sense?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a wonderful thing to have all this rich diversity, and it's a wonderful thing to have growth. I mean, I think sometimes we don't appreciate how great we have it, that we have a population that's growing and that we have small towns around, even in greater Minnesota, that are growing. And much of that growth is fueled by populations of color.
I raise the question because there's a sense that there may be some fear white populations that are traditional legacy populations may feel that they are losing opportunity and potentially losing power because their numbers are shrinking and the communities of color are growing.
Yeah.
Is there that discussion anywhere that you are aware of, and how does it play out?
Sure, I mean, I hear it on the television, and I hear it when I speak to people in real life as well.
What are the fears?
The fear, I think, is for one's own position in the labor force, in one's own economic stability. But I can't speak directly to it. That's what I think it is. Mm-hmm. But what I can say for the state of Minnesota is that we have a slightly different picture than for the U.S. overall. And that's a picture of, even though I said, we're growing as a state and we have many communities that are growing, our labor force isn't growing a whole lot. And so I think, when we look at the role of new Americans and populations of color who have not been included in the labor force at the same rates as non-Hispanic whites, I think that it's a critical part of Minnesota in particular, just because we're growing relatively slowly.
Keith, let me bring you in here. Thank you for being here. The story of the day here and around the world is the Republican ascendance to the seat of power at the state level and at the national level with President Trump and with the emergence of Republican leadership in both the House and Senate in Minnesota. How does it make you feel, first of all? And how do you describe what's the phenomenon that has driven this significant change in the country from your point of view?
Well, in terms of what it means for us and how we feel, honestly, it's a significant responsibility when you are given, granted by the voters, the opportunity to govern. And so we have an obligation in Washington, D.C., with all three entities that pass legislation to get the job done and make sure that we remember the voice of those voters who spoke pretty loudly on a number of issues in the election. And we feel if we do, then in the end, that's going to be good for our country and good for everyone everywhere. And so we're very happy and encouraged and glad to have that opportunity, but it's a big responsibility too. Here in Minnesota, with two branches of the legislature, obviously we have to work with a governor who won't agree with us on everything. So we feel it's incumbent on us to advance a really strong agenda. And then realize that at the end of the day, you've got to negotiate and pass a budget and agree on dimensions of policy. So it's a tremendous opportunity, one that we welcome.
Mm-hmm. What are things that are going to be on your front burner for legislature this session in Minnesota?
In Minnesota, the key things obviously are passing a budget. That's the essential purpose of this first year of the two-year legislative cycle. And then within that, hopefully advancing some policy changes. Clearly, we need to fix the healthcare situation and Obamacare. Clearly, we have an opportunity after huge tax increases 4 years ago that have produced commensurably huge surpluses to get at some tax reform and to return some of that excess revenue at the state back to people and let them do their good things with it. On the education front, I think we have a huge challenge in Minnesota with the achievement gap and the broader opportunity gap that spawns. We're hopeful that a number of our initiatives will actually get more play and more support in the budget. So there's a handful of things. The interesting thing about the state is that, especially after an election year like last year where there were these big national waves, mm-hmm. Where you could argue that national security and border security and safety at home and jobs in the economy and Obamacare and healthcare reform, those are the big waves that really put Donald Trump and the Republicans in their position in Washington, D.C. And so as they address those things over the next 2 years, our ability to either incorporate and respond to that will in large part be driven by what happens in Washington. So when big wave elections occur like that and then the waves of legislation and policy come out of Washington, D.C., the states need to react to that and fine-tune it in a way that works for Minnesota.
Describe a theory of government that distinguishes Republicans from Democrats, particularly in Minnesota. Here's my 30-second analysis, and you can either expound on it or shape it differently, that Democrats in general believe that there's an appropriate role of government to be an arbiter, to be a negotiator and an enabler of more citizen engagement, citizen access to resources, of leveling the playing field to allow more people to do better. Republicans, on the other hand, believe that government overreaches and that that role is left best to the free market and to individuals acting in their own agency. Is that correct or not correct? How different am I, is my analysis from what you think is the case?
Well, it's probably a fair assessment. I think Republicans just have an innate belief in people. Mm-hmm. We look at people as individuals created in the image of God, each of them accountable and valuable and uniquely equipped to engage in life and to pursue good things. We trust in them to do that. We, by and large, trust in our families, in our neighborhoods, in our local communities. We trust businesses, by and large, to do the right thing. And so the historical American notion, and I think the founding notion of our party under Abraham Lincoln, emancipating the slaves, is that that freedom, that liberty, within an ordered society is a really good thing, and people can flourish. And we've seen untold prosperity and opportunity and good things for people in our country as a result of that system. And so to the extent that government encroaches on that and actually proves counterproductive, We feel that there's a proper balance, that there is a role for government in a limited set of things and in a limited way. But to the extent that it starts to constrain liberty and freedom and people's ability to do good things, the extent to which it takes from one and gives to another, and so all of the power is now centered in the place where that giving and taking occurs. When the government imposes itself on economic markets, and now my business is less about developing a good product or service that somebody's going to want, but my energy is focused on getting myself on the approved list at government agencies, all of a sudden you've turned this other entity into an arbiter. And in a free market system, when you and I conduct a free exchange, the golden rule is applied. You and I aren't going to enter into a free exchange unless it's better for you and better for me for us to do that, right? And so at the core of a free market system is an incentive for good things to happen and for people to come together through free association. So that's really what we're fighting for. And in this day and age, when you look at certain things, for example, the economic performance for minorities or the performance of schools in our urban core, you have to also look at it and say, what actually works?
Let's look at economics. And from the model you've described, is there evidence that that has delivered value and opportunity to black people in particular, minorities in general? I believe it has not. I think it's a great idea, great concept. It sounds good, feels good, mm-hmm. but the reality belies or reflects something different. What do you think? I'm asking for the evidence that this philosophy has produced value, opportunity, growth, engagement for black people.
I think as I look at the particulars that we would face here in Minnesota, for example, we just had 8 years of an administration and now 8 years of Governor Dayton, including 2 years when Democrats had complete control of state government to address a number of these things. And they chose the bigger government route. And I remember I was sitting in front of a college group a couple weeks after the election, and all of a sudden it hit me that this group of students had known nothing other than President Obama and effectively Democrats putting forward this notion that, you know, part-time minimum wage job with government providing your health care and your housing and your transportation and your education and maybe your food and your home heating oil and your child care, maybe even your job, that's kind of the vision of the American dream. And I don't think that is really for most people. And so you look also at women's economic factors after those 8 years of those policies going in, and economic advance didn't occur for minorities. You look at the schools under 50 years of Democrat rule in the inner cities and the unions running these public schools, and they are producing the results. And so, you know, Donald Trump, say what you want, he might have been coarse in saying it, but this idea of what have you got to lose, why don't we look at some different models? And I'll give you a perfect example.
Before you do, we'll talk about it in a minute.
All right.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Keith Downey, chair of the Republican Party, and he's going to give a perfect example of what went wrong when we come back. Then we'll be joined by the challenging point of view, Anika Robbins, Black Votes Matter, and Hollis Winston, who represents the African American Caucus in Minnesota's DFL. Stay tuned. Be right back. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. So Keith Downey, you're chair of the Republican Party of Minnesota, you wanted to give an example of how things could be different.
Sure. Shortly after I became chair, we actually moved our offices from over inside the Beltway, if you will, in St. Paul, over right into the heart of Minneapolis, 22nd and Franklin, actually arguably the highest percentage Somali neighborhood. And we did that for a number of reasons, recognizing that we do need to reach out to all different kinds of communities and constituencies in Minnesota. And it's been a great experience for us to get to know the neighbors and the people in that area. And I was approached by a group of workforce entities, four minority workforce councils, who were extremely frustrated in that all of the funding coming out of the state government, the Department of Employment and Economic Development, was going to the state-run workforce centers. And their criticism of those centers was that they assisted people with resume preparation, but their big goal was to help provide all of the wraparound human services. And these four entities were struggling to get any kind of funding from the state to deliver real workforce training. And the goal of all four of those minority entities trying to do training in the urban core was to get people trained to the point where they could have a living wage, a job, a full-time job. I don't remember what their income goal was, but it was pretty high. It was $30,000 or $40,000 with health care. That was the training they were trying to provide. And what do they run into? They run into the state bureaucracy wanting to run its statewide workforce centers that don't provide that kind of training. They aren't as nimble. They aren't in the community. They aren't sensitized to the needs of the members of those communities. And so it was a classic example where well-intentioned workforce centers run by the state with a huge budget are doing something that isn't as productive, might in fact even be counterproductive to people getting back to work. And the very folks in those minority communities trying to do the good work of equipping and training people in those communities is stunted because of that reallocation of resources. So it's a classic example in my mind of how the minority communities equipped and doing their own good work would be far more effective than what the state is doing.
And what you're saying is you're prepared to shift the funding away from existing state agencies and organizations and place it directly in the hands of minority entrepreneurs and organizations that are doing good in their own description of that in their communities?
That would be a fundamental premise of much of what Republicans try to do to take it out of the bureaucracy and equip people in their neighborhoods and in their communities to do good things.
There's no history of that ever having happened before under any other Republican administration.
Well, as soon as we get a Republican governor in 2018 and have the majorities, we'll try.
Let me bring up some Democrats to talk about this conversation. You know, I thank you for being here. I have to say that it's been rare for me to have a chance to engage with a leader of the Republican Party or spokespeople from the Republican Party. My personal orientation, obviously, is Democratic, DFL, mm-hmm. and I'm, I think, progressive. So I disclose that. My intent is consistent with progressive politics. So I find myself on the opposite side of you, but I appreciate the chance to connect and engage with you here.
Well,
so this
thank
is a great
you very
thing.
Much. It's an honor to be with you.
So Hollis, let's respond. I want you to talk about the work of the African American Caucus of the DFL, first of all, and you know what and how you are analyzing. What do you in terms of the recent election cycle?
I guess first, I just wanted to respond briefly to what Keith said. I mean, in terms of, you know, local organizations saying we want to build out a certain approach and the state apparatus is getting in the way, you know, that's akin to even how corporations work. And I'll get back to what you asked fairly shortly. But that's akin to how corporations work. You know, I've worked for a number of Fortune 500 companies. I don't necessarily want to talk about them right now, but it isn't easy for them to change on a dime either. And I think in some cases, when we're talking about the government, it's very easy to attack certain programs and processes that they've built out. And then it's very easy for someone to say, well, they're doing X, Y, and Z, which is holding us back. But then actually getting in there, and I think Al's point, getting in there and then you did not actually commit to getting that funding into those folks' hands, right? You said, well, part of our approach is to let the locals do it. But getting in there, going through the legislative process, getting the government processes set up where they can give those people the funding and the understanding, that's a very different conversation, right? So it's easy to attack them, but then if you talk to a Fortune 500 with 20,000 employees, they don't just turn on a dime either. As to what the African American DFL caucus is doing, you know, we've had a new board in place for about a year. So the focus before that was primarily to maybe attend certain events, use it as a platform to maybe criticize certain politics that were coming from the Republican Party or some things that were happening at the state. And we realized that we would be much more useful, not only to the DFL, but primarily to our community if we were to build out some programs where we actually get out there and door knock and canvas. And we felt the best way to do that, to really engage our community, because we know as a party that we have to really engage our community much better, was we worked with youth. Initially, it was primarily from the north side, and then we began pulling youth from Brooklyn Park and other areas. So we worked with them, trained them on how to canvas, and then we partnered them up with a mentor, and were able to raise a reasonable amount of money to give them scholarships. And so they would go out and canvas, but we also made sure that they understood about basic civics. So when we began talking to a lot of the youth initially, we said, well, who makes your laws? They'd say, well, the governor. And we'd say, well, as a Democrat, if it was that easy at this point, right? But we have these checks and balances. So then we had to say, well, there's the House, there's a state House, and there's a state Senate. And then we had to help them understand at a federal level. And some understood better than others, but some had no idea how their government worked. So we gave them a brief civics lesson, went out and canvassed. And using that approach, we were able to go out and door knock on, 5,000-6,000 doors. And I don't want to get into folks we specifically supported, but we had, it was a tough election cycle, so we had some losses, but we also had some wins that we're very proud of. You know, some things we learned from that is, one, our education system, and this is a whole different conversation, but our education system needs to do a lot better in terms of educating youth on the civic institutions that make America what it is, that make America already great, right? So we need to do a much better job on that. If we do that, it's a lot easier for youth to want to engage. But we also learned that in terms of branding, DFL has a decent reputation within the community, but we need to have a better reputation, and we need to be even more engaged than we are currently. So to do that, we really want to build out that youth mentor program, and because it's kind of a soft approach. Instead of me walking off the street and saying, Al, I need you to come out here and canvas and door knock, and you say, well, I was really just planning on going to dinner and watching a movie with my wife. Mm-hmm. If I get your child involved, your child comes home and your child says, well, I'm involved with this program. I told you about the program. I'm involved with the program. They're doing X, Y, and Z. Here's the candidates. And the parents say, really? And then they start asking questions. So it's a better approach. I think it's an approach that addresses some of the issues that we see down the road, with the younger community being engaged. And it was actually relatively successful, this campaign.
Hollis Winston, what's your own background? You told me that the name Hollis Winston is a three-generation name, your son, you, and your father. So there's legacy here. What's your family story?
Very much part of the, if you look at that Southern African-American diaspora that moved from, so grandparents originally from Arkansas, Mississippi, moved to South Side of Chicago. Well, actually South Side of Chicago for my father, West Side for my mother. My mother moved up to the South Side. Father was first generation lawyer and then got his MBA. Mother, first generation college graduate. And there was an opportunity up here, actually, in 1989 for them to work for, I'm dating myself, but NSP. And so my dad actually worked his way up to be a VP at NSP. And my mom did very well up here, too.
NSP is the accelerator.
Yeah, they're now Xcel Energy. So I didn't get the law degree. I went to law for school for about a year, and I said, this isn't for me. This is a lot of work for something I don't love. But I did get the MBA down the road. And then went and currently work for a pharmaceutical benefits management company. Prior to that, I had worked for a few corporations and got my feet wet, and briefly had owned my own company as a personal trainer. So heavy business background, getting involved in politics is something relatively new.
I'm glad to see
you. Yeah, new to me.
Let me bring Anika in. Anika is a friend for many, many years with me, also an entrepreneur, a serial entrepreneur, but a person who's also a cultural icon, both here and nationally, and now is joining this conversation talking about the mission, the vision of Black Votes Matter. Let's start with that. Let's describe the Black Votes Matter initiative, and we'll go out from there.
Okay, thank you. Black Votes Matter, Minnesota, is a nonpartisan voter engagement and leadership development initiative. We're part of a broader coalition, Minnesota Voices. So what you see is a coalition of several multicultural organizations who are mobilized around engaging their own constituents. And so our focus, obviously, is the African-American community. And for me, you know, much like Hollis and several other folks, including several of the Minneapolis City Council candidates, these are everyday regular citizens, many of us coming from the arts and business background, who are recognizing the need to deepen our engagement. And so a lot of what we've done, you know, last year was our pilot year. We launched. Myself personally, as a mother, you know, I'm the mother of a six-year-old son. My husband and I are both Northside residents and business owners and have been for the last 25 years. And you just get to a place where you're tired of crying for the loss of other mothers' sons. And you want to engage, you don't know how, you feel like you need a certain amount of criteria, eligibility to engage in politics in your community, and you recognize it's really everyday people who recognize they have a right to participate, and so we do. Our focus has been on education and engagement. What we found is that, you know, a lot of times folks get approached by both political parties and others, and a candidate is foisted onto them, but there's really not connected, it doesn't really connect the individual to why they should vote and why it matters to them. And so the beauty of being in the nonpartisan space is that we're able to kind of strip away, you know, vote for this person or this personality, and really get folks to zero in on the issues that matter to them, why voting matters, how it does make a difference. Folks have heard rhetoric for years, you know, your vote, your voice matters. What does that really mean? And so we've really done a deeper dive into helping people understand exactly how their vote matters. So around education, health, housing, what departments should you direct your issues to? You know, when Jamar Clark was killed by Minneapolis police last winter, you know, we have our two representatives, Bobby Champion and Senator Hayden. And so everyone feels like these are the go-to when really some of these issues can be addressed on a city level. But you don't know that. You just go to the two kind of figureheads of black leadership, but that's really not their role per se. And so we really recognize the need to unpack the layers of government. And as you said, you know, a deep need for civic engagement starting in the schools. It used to be there, but it's no longer, along with several other programs that have been cut out of the school system, right? So the idea is to just help people understand their role as a citizen and how much power they do in fact have, and it begins with their vote. And also showing them how to engage with legislators, with the political parties. You know, our historically, you know, African Americans, we have perfected the art of the protest. But we really now need to model what real civic engagement looks like. How do we deepen that? And that's with attending city council meetings. It's going to the state capitol. It's calling your legislator. One good thing that I can say that has come out of the most recent election and the new regime is that folks are recognizing that you cannot fall asleep at the wheel. You cannot leave the heavy lifting and the voting to everyone else. We saw that basically 30% of the country made a decision for the rest of us. So those were the amount of people that voted for our new president. And so we saw 70%, 57%, she could probably correct me, did not engage at all. And so that really speaks to a broader disconnect in our country between cities, urban and rural, between cultures. Everyone's advocating their specific issues, but there's really no kind of consensus around what are the core issues. And so we're starting brass tacks with Black Votes Matter Minnesota and just letting people know that it's important to start there. And you don't have to know everything. You simply have to engage. There's several people that are available that can provide that information. We went into the schools last cycle and just really spent some time in high schools talking to youth about it. We talked to a lot of adults. A lot of folks are, you know, they don't want to admit that they are not as politically savvy as they feel like they should be. And so a lot of time and energy is spent on basic civic engagement and then modeling and mentoring and guiding people through the conversation.
So the presumption, and I could be wrong, is that you're mobilizing and organizing people to who are likely going to be involved in the Democratic Party. But you're not saying that.
No, we're not saying that. I need to be clear that we're not saying that.
So let's talk about that.
Yes. We are, again, nonpartisan. So we're not funneling people anywhere. What we're simply doing is getting people to vote their issues, to vote, period. And so we do a lot of digging content generation because, for instance, people are not used to researching candidates. They're not used to knowing where to look for information on candidates. So it's really a grassroots effort in making sure that people are fully engaged, know where to get the information, and then understand what issues are important to them and how to begin to advocate for them.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's jump in. How does this align with what you're doing?
I think it aligns very well. I think you made a great point, Anika, when you were talking about, so if we talk about Philando Castile, and we talk about a lot of the, issues that African Americans have historically had with law enforcement, right? Senator Champion, Representative Moran, Senator Hayden are only going to be able to do so much just because of how the government is organized. And so engaging folks at a municipal level, with that city council level, getting very involved at the mayoral level, even with your sheriff, right, and beginning to understand those policies is I think, relatively new to the African-American community. And if we look back in history and you say, well, you really got that right to vote in the 60s, right? I mean, you fought for it. You were granted it, but you had the poll tax and all these other issues. So now someone says, hey, you got the right to vote. And then someone says, now get out there and engage like people have been doing this for 200 years who come from a culture who have been really engaging this. So we're going to really push people to get involved at that precinct caucus level. That's the most basic level. That's where at a neighborhood level, you get to go and you get to determine and have conversations about who's going to go to that next level. At the ward level, ultimately, the terms going to the conventions. That's where you start determining this is going to be the person we're going to vote to be the mayoral candidate for the DFL. And so I think a lot of times, I know a lot of times African Americans, other people of color, actually Americans in general, will say, well, these are candidates that the DFL gave me. This is the candidates that the Republican and the GOP gave me, right? And I know a lot of party insiders will say, all you had to do was show up at the precincts. If you'd showed up at the precincts and fought, we'd have a different candidate. So it's beholden on us to get people involved and understand at that level is where those decisions are made.
I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We'll continue with this conversation after these messages. Come back. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane. I want to take a minute to do sort of an internal conversation with Anika and with Hollis Winston. You know, when we are alone in our neighborhood, we talk about politics all day and all night. And so we are engaged. We are concerned about it. So Hollis, as an operator in the DFL, as a chair of the DFL's African American Caucus, is there a discussion inside that body about the genuineness of the DFL in engaging and embracing and supporting and advancing black interest as described by black people? Or is there resistance to leadership of black people in the DFL?
If I'm honest, it's a mix of both, right? So you have camps that say, well, when you were pointing out the demographics, right? To win, the DFL knows that down the road they're going to have African Americans much more engaged. They're going to have great candidates to continue to engage the community. But the membership of the DFL, just like any other party, represents the state that it's in. So you have some folks who are maybe not as familiar with African-American issues who, you know, I think you pointed out some folks are worried about, well, where am I going to land in terms of the job market, right? So some of those folks are not as keen on pulling in African-American leadership. It doesn't mean they're saying, basically, I don't want it. It's not necessary. They're just not going to go out of their way, right? So you have the two camps, and I think we sit around all the time, and we have to strategize as a caucus, and we have to say, we take a little bit different approach than maybe in the past. We say, well, on one level, we need to push the DFL to do the right thing. Mm-hmm. On another level, we also have the discussion about how do we strategize? How do we put ourselves in a position where we have a critical mass of there's going to be African-American leader in some high-level capacity no matter what? Because strategically, we found a way to put those people there while also building a larger coalition. So it may sound like I'm talking in circles. It's not an easy conversation. Politics is not necessarily easy in and of itself, but it is something that we sit around and talk about all the time. I know one thing that we have to do as a caucus and as a party, and I think folks are not always comfortable, we have to look at, and this could be some of my business background speaking, but if Coke doesn't sell as many Cokes, Coke cannot go to people who buy soft drinks and say, well, how dare you not buy a Coke? We're the best product out there. Coke has to say, well, do we create a new product? How do we market ourselves? What is it that people are looking for in this particular
beverage? The DFL is doing that, number one.
The DFL is getting much better. I think under the leadership of Ken Martin, mm-hmm. They're doing a much better job. But it's a team sport, so Ken can speak to certain things, but leadership within the DFL, African-American leadership within the DFL, also has to do that.
Anika, not speaking as a DFLer, but as a person who's interested in getting people to vote,
in
black votes of Black Votes Matter, I guess. Uh-huh. Is the Democratic Party aggressively and genuinely responding to the voices of our community, number one? Is the Republican Party responding to our presence and our description of what opportunity looks like for us? How do we navigate and negotiate our interest in ways that, number one, protect and reflect our dignity and our
sure.
right and responsibility to be co-equal partners
sure.
in the execution of life itself?
Sure.
What do you think?
Be kind to us. You
ain't
It's coming. To the first question, no. No. So a lot of what, and I'm just going to basically speak to what we heard on the streets, you know. So we conducted a rigorous grassroots effort, canvassing, door knocking, street corners, everything. Another reason why the results were as they were is because people are turned off by both parties. The deal between Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton turned a lot of people off, and it made people, they were disenfranchised, you know, just done with politics, with government, and in particular with the DFL. So it's known in circles that there's some discord within the DFL around black leadership. And, you know, I've had conversations with DFL leadership. There's a need for an image makeover. There needs to be some kind of unified message, both to African-American constituents, but the broader narrative about what is the DFL going to stand for. It seems like it's always reacting versus maybe being proactive in laying out agenda, laying out policies, approach, engagement, you know. And historically, well, since maybe the 70s, I think it's been implied or assumed that African Americans are going to vote Democratic. And to your question about should we explore other parties, and I think many are, but there's also kind of this pushback because if you're black, you're supposed to be a Democrat. But as more and more people start really deepening their engagement, exploring what the issues are and what they mean to them, people are starting to explore other parties, whether it's the Republican Party, whether it's the Independent or the Green Party. There's a lot of talk about Blexit, where African Americans are basically like, why don't we just create our own party, a different party? So people are exploring. They're completely turned off.
If you do, you guarantee you'll be out of power forever. That's what I think the answer there is there.
Because I wanted
because the Democratic Party has been and remains the vehicle for black political empowerment.
Sure.
As imperfect as that is,
sure.
And we've come so far.
Sure.
The question is, how do we ramp up, and take control, and figure out how we create opportunities that represent an inclusiveness that all Americans benefit from? That's what I think.
I agree. I mean, I have a friend, Noel Nix, who gave me an analogy, right? The DFL, Republican, Green Party, whatever party you're talking about, it's basically a car. It's an apparatus. It's a machine. And so there's a fight to determine who's going to drive that machine, right? And that's where you get your troops, you get your strategy, you use. What I would tell the community is, it's not about the African-American caucus using you. It's really about you using the African-American caucus to get what you need politically or in terms of resources. And so that's a newer concept because people just haven't necessarily been invited to the table. I would also tell folks that the DFL, and that's what I was trying to get at, that analogy with the Coke, DFL does need to do a better job, right? But they need to do a better job. Statewide, they need to do a better job. And that's part of what elections help us say. Do we need to hone in on a better message, right? So we really need to improve that aspect of ourselves. But it's not something where African Americans are not welcome. It's just, here's the point. When you go play football, two teams are competing for that trophy. Well, when you play politics, you are competing for everything. Mm-hmm. You're competing for who gets the jobs, whose street gets cleaned, whose trash gets taken out, who the police pull over, don't pull over. Those are all things that are super important. So people are going to mobilize, and they're going to fight extremely hard for that. The only caveat I would say, because I never tell people, don't start a party, don't do this, don't look around. I would say, to Al's point, basic game theory. We don't live in a parliamentary democracy where the more you get a certain number of people, you get a certain level of representation, right? We live in a winner-take-all system. You explore too much, you pull too many people away, you have no seat at the table.
And so, Keith, you'd be happy to see a third party splintering black people out from the Democrats, right?
Actually, you know, I don't know that I would.
Okay.
Al. And I appreciate the chance before the break to have articulated why Republicans think that we're the right answer for everybody, mm-hmm. including the minority communities. And, you know, I look around the table and I would tell each one of you, you know, I believe in you. At the same time, Republicans have had our eyes opened wide after the 2012 election about the disconnect between our party and communities of color and young people and women. And we have embarked on a very intentional effort. Identified 12 constituencies or communities, including four different minority communities, and intentionally launched outreach initiatives. And we're trying to do it not on the cheap. I can't show up in your community in September with a Spanish language brochure and expect that you're going to vote for us. We're trying to build organic leadership within those communities so that we actually build a relationship. We know who you are. We know what your issues are. You have confidence that we're actually on your side and that we're actually doing things that are good for you. We have different degrees of development, but we have 8 affiliate organizations, a very well-developed Hispanic Republican Assembly of Minnesota. They have ongoing leadership and elections, and they advance delegates in our process. We actually elected 2 Hispanic members to the state legislature. We were the first, mind you, to have a Somali American endorsed as a candidate for state legislature, Abdi Malik Askar, 4 years ago. So we're very proud of what we've done, and yet we realize we have miles to go, and we're not going to kind of come in and say, you know, vote for us and buy your vote or reach out. It's got to be an organic build, and it's got to be over the long haul. People need to know that we trust, that they trust us and that we trust them and that we're looking out for their best interests. So we're going to do our absolute best. So as compared to forming a Blaxit, you know, boy, we sure need our opportunity, I think, to earn your confidence in your vote because our policies would actually help your communities.
Go ahead.
I would say,
you know, there's not a lot of specifics in that, but I would say, you know, if you look at what Governor Dayton is proposing for his budget, right, and Minnesota is a unique opportunity. I think we have more Fortune 500 companies per capita than anywhere else in the United States. And what scares me is that, you know, I have three children, 11, 12, and one. And what scares me is that I think they'll be okay. But when we talk about maintaining that educated workforce to keep those Fortune 500, which kind of guarantees the lifestyle, the quality of life that many Minnesotans take for granted, where is that talent going to come from for the next generation, right? They have Minnesota has issues bringing in talent from other states and keeping that talent, right? So it's something where it's going to have to be homegrown. And so when you look at Governor Dayton's budget and you say he's trying to grow, you know, put more resources into K through 12 education, why? Because that's where people get the foundation to be able to participate down the road in this Fortune 500, you know, state that we have. And a lot of other states can't even come close to what we have to offer, right?
So, Keith, with the Republicans' support investing more aggressively in pre-K education, in supporting, you know, families, getting kids ready for school?
I think Republicans have a history of investing in education for what works. Mm-hmm. And that is the absolute key factor here. And I don't mean to be...
For example.
I don't mean to be overly partisan, mm-hmm. But you look at the big city school districts, which have been run by Democrats and the unions, and that the cities themselves have been run by Democrats literally for 50 years. And you look at the absence of performance and that achievement gap statistic doesn't get any better. And, you know, as just a father and somebody whose dad was a teacher, you look at that and you know, you're almost outraged. And how is this possible? And we keep throwing more and more money into these systems and structures that don't work. So I guess if you thought that money was the answer, A, you would have seen results from it in the past, and B, you'd put more into it. But we don't see that. We see other structures, charters, and other things that work. Scholarships, early education scholarships, as compared to the bureaucracy and the unions taking over pre-K in the state. So I think we're focused on what works, and it has to work for everyone. But Hollis, I agree. We have an economic environment and a tax climate here. We're exporting wealth. We're exporting businesses. Business startup formation has lagged in Minnesota under these really oppressive economic policies of the Democrats. And so, again, I think Donald Trump, in an interesting way, has opened up an opportunity for us to engage in that conversation and hopefully have a productive conversation about what actually will work for the minority communities.
The conversation has to include that under the Obama administration, jobs have increased by more than 9 million. The job openings have gone up 97%. The consumer prices, that the earnings of consumers have increased by 3.4%. Unemployment rates dropped to about 5% nationwide, and so.
Can I interrupt?
Go ahead, please do. Yeah.
Because that is not true for the minority community, mm-hmm. and for women. If you look at the economic statistics for the African American community, you know, average median household income dropping or remaining stagnant, and so these areas. Again, not to put an overly partisan point on it, but these areas where Democrats have been in control and running economic and tax policy and the like haven't produced the results. And so I think, to your point, whether you feel abandoned by the DFL for other reasons, there's an opportunity for the Republicans to come in and say, you know what, let's look at some of these things. Let's pilot some of these things.
Actually,
let's do some of these things and see how they work.
The numbers for business growth among African-American women has also grown in the last 8 to 12 years. So I do want to point that out. In fact, it's the fastest segment of business growing in the U.S. So, you know, I think the other pushback where the Republican Party is concerned is black people feel oftentimes that our issues are used to kind of pander to the public, but then once, you know, bills are passed and agendas are accomplished, then abandoned. And so I think there's a need for transparency, authenticity. Al, to your question about what can be done, I think it's important for us to be very clear about what our issues are. I think the DFL needs to do, just like I said, it's an image problem. It's a branding and messaging, but it begins internally. So once some of those things within leadership are solved, then it trickles down and it starts to reflect out into your ability to attract more people. You can't say well, we're the best game in town. I think you might have said that. It can't be assumed. You have to actively issue an invitation. And I would say that across both parties. So rather than saying, well, we're all that's here, you can't say that to this voter today. This voter is expecting a little bit more. This voter has questions. Today's voter didn't vote. And so the challenge to both parties then is, what are you going to do to attract people to your brand? And so you use Coke. Coke, even though it is, you know, arguably the leader of Coke-type products, but they still advertise, they still market worldwide. Why do they do that? Mm-hmm. Because every day, so even though, you know, we might dismiss a Blackxit movement, we can't dismiss its existence and the fact that we are here and these are real conversations happening around the country. And so the dismissiveness is also a turnoff.
I wouldn't discourage somebody from doing that, right? I wouldn't dismiss a Blackxit. What I would say is, just strategically, if I look at the numbers,
sure.
And this would be...
We don't want to split the vote, and I may get that.
Yeah, and if I had a conversation with a brother or sister on the street, and they mm-hmm. said, well, Blackxit, I'd say, well, here's the numbers, right? This is the way it looks. Go on and do it. You know, I'll support you if you're trying to help the community, but there has to be that real strategic conversation, which
absolutely.
I think the more we have of that, actually, which is folks who are interested, the more you have these strategic conversations, the more people look up and say, oh, you're willing to have a conversation with me? I think I might be a little bit more interested, right?
Sure.
We have not always had those conversations, right? But I do believe in terms of, you know, investment in education, you know, supporting families and different things like that. You know, the DFL has done things, DFL leadership has done things, but I think it's like, to your point with Coke, we have to do a better job of saying, when we go to bat, for minimum wage, for local cities to say we're going to have a minimum wage, we're the party that fights for that. And why is that important to you? What does that translate into, right? And we have to do a better job with that.
And coalition building is important. And that's something that we've really done with Black Votes Matter is we work across 25 different organizations and 50 when you count our broader collaborative. And that's something that historically we tend to operate in our silos. And so I think across lines, finding the common ground, and that's really our focus going forward. You know, we talked about the disconnect between cities and the rural areas. There is a disconnection there. But how do we bridge that? So having conversations, one-on-one conversations, building broader coalitions, finding the common ground, and then building around that, I think that's where you can start to see some changes.
So, Hollis, I expect to see you. I know that I'll see you and members of the organization in the neighborhood that I live in, North Minneapolis, right? That's a given.
Yeah.
But, Keith, I don't know when I'll ever see anybody from your party in my neighborhood. What's going to happen? I've got 30 seconds. How are you going to engage and try to capture my interest?
Fair critique, and we don't have any elected representation probably in your neighborhood, and so there's not that automatic vehicle for doing that. And that is our challenge. And listening to this conversation today, it strikes me a little bit that our challenge is actually, I think, a huge opportunity for us, and we need to be about it. You know, if you want political power within the Democrats, I understand how that might be seen as the vehicle or the historical vehicle. But if you want real opportunity in life, you know, there's going to be an unleashing of investment and entrepreneurship and growth and opportunity with the changes that we put in place. I think people's upside is off the charts right now. And so I would encourage the African-American community, and it's incumbent on us to go out and have this kind of conversation. I'd encourage them to give us a chance. I really think life can be better, and we've got solutions and opportunities that they should at least check out as part of their political calculation.
We'll leave it there. Thank you all for being here. This has been a great conversation. My guest, Hollis Winston, who's chair of the African-American Caucus of the Minnesota DFL Party. Keith Downey, chair of the Republican Party of Minnesota. Susan Brower is Minnesota's state demographer, and Anika Robbins, an entrepreneur, cultural icon, here representing the movement Black Votes Matter. Well, obviously, it's so important that we continue this conversation. I believe we have to demonstrate our intentionality, the inevitability, and the great, you know, imminent nature of political empowerment, political success, but it begins with us. This conversation is how we do it. Join us again for Conversations with Al McFarlane. Bye-bye.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say goodnight. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation.